This is Harry Murray at Murray's Fly Shop in Edinburgh, Virginia. We're going to talk a little bit about the trout fishing we do for the wild trout in the mountain streams. The difference between the wild trout and the hatchery trout, they're both good trout fishing, but you'll learn more and you'll accomplish more fishing for the wild trout in the mountain streams. The hatchery fish, sort of like fishing at a goldfish pond, but you're not going to master anything, especially in those stock streams. However, in the mountain streams, once you get a handle on those, you can fish anywhere in the world because you're getting the cornerstones of all fly fishing, because these are wild fish. The time that we start fishing for the wild trout in the mountain streams is usually middle of March. It all comes right down to water temperature. For my personal thinking, I base this on 40 degrees. If I get 40 degree water temperature for 4 consecutive days, that is telling me things are starting to hatch. What is happening is the hatches are growing. They may not quite be ready to emerge from the stream, but at 40 degrees for 4 consecutive days, the nymphs are approaching their full size, especially the Epilus pluralis, the old Quill Gordon. He's reaching full size after 4 days of 40 degrees. The other thing that happens at that time, water temperature, is the metabolic needs for the trout is turning then on. They are now getting hungry. They need to feed, and they will feed. So once we get into that, then we're on go. You can fish nymphs. You can fish dries. Obviously, the nymphs and the emerger will be coming along before the dries are on the surface. The first hatch we get, which comes on usually about the second week of March, is the Epilus pluralis. That's the one we always call the Quill Gordon. Those nymphs get real active in the riffles that you'll see. They'll move to the lower part of that riffle. They'll be lying in the rocks in the lower part of the riffle, ready to come off. Now, when that water temperature comes up to where it's holding at that 40 degree I mentioned, if it's holding there, for five or six days at 40 degrees, those nymphs are going to be on the downstream side of those rocks. They will come off on, I'm talking about the Epilus pluralis now, not all of them, but that Epilus pluralis will come off. Now, he plays a special game. He's one of the few mayflies that actually comes off the stream bottom with his wings partly sticking out on the top. If you look at our Mr. Rapidan emerger, you'll see that we have a wing actually protruding off his back, and that's what the real thing does. He'll come off, and then by, say, the third week in March, he's ready to come off, and he's going to have come off the stream, fly over to the tree limbs, sit there 1 or 2 days, shed the skin, come back to the stream as the adult, the spinner. They'll mate, deposit their eggs, and then that's the end of the road. The adult in that guy is only going to last 2 days. But that's going to give you pretty good strong action throughout all the latter part of March and actually into maybe the middle of April. So you've got that, and that is our biggest hatch. I was coming out of a mountain stream one time over in the Blue Ridge, and I was headed back to my car about an hour before dark, and I was coming down a very tall, very high ridge over a canyon, and I was looking west as I was headed out of there. Now, I had the duns hatching off, and I had the spinners coming back. We're talking about 1 hour before daylight, one hour before dark, and let's put a label on it. Let's say the first week of April. The duns are coming off. The spinners are coming back. And when I was sitting on that log looking out over that canyon, which was probably about 500 feet deep, there's no doubt in my mind that there were 1,000 mayflies in the air. And that will turn the trout on like crazy. Now, what we're going to use to match that is the quill gourd. When I was designing flies, I designed one to match that quill gourd mayfly, and also it does match the March brown. The tackle we use in these mountain streams is more demanding than what we would use to fish, say, Big Stony or Passage Creek or something like that. What we need is a rod that'll give us accuracy and delicacy in the distance, we'll say 15 feet out to 40 feet. You just simply need to hit what you're shooting at. If you want to put numbers on there, I would say a rod someplace between 6.5 and 7.5 feet. That'll handle a number 2, 3, or 4 line. Now, that's putting it straight out in numbers. Now, when you pick that rod up, the numbers get lost. You've got to be able to hit what you're shooting at. I don't mean teacup accuracy, but you doggone well better get dinner plate accuracy 15 feet away from you, because that trout is going to be out there feeding. He's coming up. He's on a feeding station. He's coming up and sipping in dry flies. So you've got to be able to drop it maybe 2 feet above him and get that drift back to you. The Murray Mountain Trout Rod, which is by far the most popular one we sell, is 6 feet, 10 inches long, breaks down to 3 pieces, handles the number 3 line. It's just a matter of putting the fly where you want it. It took them 11 months to perfect that. They kept sending them in here. I test them back and forth and back and forth. The chief rod builder out there after 11 months called me after I was testing the last one. And he said, "Harry, what'd you think about it?" And a little boy's name was J.D. Street, little African-American and very knowledgeable. Said, "What'd you think?" Well, I was getting embarrassed because I really wasn't giving him an answer. And he came back again. He said, "Well, tell me, Harry." And all I was doing was saying no. Finally, he says, "Harry, the tip's too damn stiff on that rod, isn't it?" I said, "Yeah, J.D., you got to lighten it up." Well, that's when we came up with the Murray Mountain Trout Rod. But it does give you terrific accuracy, and you don't, for goodness sakes, don't overline them or underline them. The only time you do that is if the rod manufacturer has goofed. But the rod's designed to handle a 3, and you want to put a 3 on it. In fishing these small streams for the wild trout, the leader is extremely important for what we're doing. Now, keep in mind now, the leader is selected in accordance to the size fly you have. I've kind of got a rule of thumb I go by that I try to use in my classes to simplify this for people just getting into it. Basically, if you choose the size fly you're going to use, so you'll know what size fly you're going to use. Then if you divide that by 3, that tells you what size tippet you're going to use. For instance, on a stock trout stream out here, I've got a boy in here just left, going to be fishing some of the stock trout stream. He's going to go out here, maybe fishing number 12 Royal Wolf. It's number 12 divided by 3. Equals a tippet, which would be 4. He'd use 4x on that. So fly size divided by 3 equals your tippet in x's. Now, let me simplify that for what we start with in our classes. We've designed 2 different leaders that we use in our mountain trout fishing and in our spring schools. The one is the Murray's Classic leader, which is 7.5 feet long for 5x. That will cover the major part of your needs in the first month. The other one we use is what we call the Murray's Mountain Leader. That's 6 feet long and handles a 5X leader, and that's going to handle the flies you're going to be using early in the season. As we get on into the season, going down to smaller flies, we'll leave that 5X and go down to maybe a 6X leader. Once in a while, I go down to 7X later in the summer if the streams are getting low and clear. But basically, those two leaders, the classic leader that I have a friend build these, I work up formulas, and this friend builds them for me. But the classic leader, which is 7.5, tapered down to 5X for the spring, and then the Murray's Mountain Trout leader, which is 6 feet long, for 5X, that'll get you through the first month or 2 months of the season. Now, the flies that we used, what I did here was work with a very, very special friend, Art Flick, up in Westkill, New York, helped me identify these back in the, I suppose about mid-70s, or we had started trying to identify the flies that we encounter in these mountain streams here in Virginia. And actually, it overlaps a certain amount with Art's and up in the Catskills and Jimmy Mills down in the Smokies. Jimmy's flies come off a little quicker, and Art's flies come off a little later. But we're starting out that with assortments that match the hatch, so to speak. The first fly that we have coming off is that Aplis pluralis that I mentioned first. Some people back in the old days called it the Quill Gordon. Quill Gordon was a very famous fellow, but the fly doesn't look anything like the fly. After that, the blue quills start coming off, then the March Browns come off, and that is a dandy. Both that March Brown and the Aplis pluralis are well matched with the March Brown, with the Mr. Rapidan dry fly. Then they kind of get thin in the middle of the summer, middle of the spring, but you're coming on down to the Ephemerella dorothea. That's the sulfur. The sulfurs come off pretty heavily in the middle of May, and they're all the way through May into June. I have seen the dorothea as late as July. And that's what we're going to rely on. Now, we do get a little yellow stonefly. Little yellow stonefly starts coming off in the latter part of April, and that guy can be there well into July. And that is a very important fly for us. But now, we're going to get down to some of the caddis. I saw some caddis yesterday on the stream, believe it or not, and there were some fish feeding on caddis. The Mr. Rapidan Delta Wing caddis in a 16 with the ollie body is awfully hard to beat. Then when we get to the Mr. Rapidan Ant and the Flying Beetles, by, we'll say, June, the hatches are thinning out quite a bit. But the ants and the beetles, I was using both of them yesterday, that they're going to be good all the way into the fall. Now, we do not like to fish for brook trout after they start spawning. Brook trout start spawning the first part of October, and they will spawn all the way into December. So we don't like to fish for them when they are spawning. It's not so much nagging them when they're spawning. It's the fact that once they put those spawning beds down, unless you're a pretty accomplished angler, you're going to step right in the bullseye of that thing and squish 100 eggs, because it's awfully, awfully hard to discern those spawning beds after they've been down, we'll say, 10 days to 2 weeks, because I call it dusting over. There is sediment running down that stream all the time, and those spawning beds dust over after about 2 weeks. And unfortunately, for those poor eggs, the brookies lay their eggs right in the part of the stream that many times, if we're not careful, that's where we're going to walk right up the stream to get on up above. So it's awfully, awfully hard to discern those spawning beds after they've been down a couple weeks. The wading gear is sort of a matter of preference. I use hippers on all of my mountain streams, whether it's rainbows, brookies, browns, whatever. I use hip boots. Now, every now and then I get a little careless and get in over the top of them, but I find that much more comfortable than chest-high waders. I have a real good friend that he just goes ahead and uses chest-high waders. He'll roll them down and just make them waist-high if that's his game. But I would definitely go with the felt sole on this because it gives you more trackings. You can put studs on the felt soles, or you can put studs on the cleated soles. That's going to give you your maximum traction if you want to put those metal studs. The only place I would caution about putting studs on them, if you're walking in streams that are a lot of flat ledges, I've had two good friends that really busted themselves using studs on flat ledges. In fact, I really messed myself up one time down on the James when I was fishing a bass stream down there. I was climbing up a cliff and I hit those ledges with studs in my waders, and I didn't stay on that ledge very long. I was laying at the bottom of the hill 20 feet down the river. So I would go very easy on the studs unless you really know what you're doing. We conduct our trout stream schools in the spring, in April and May. What we're going to try to teach you in these streams, now I'm talking about wild trout, we're not fishing the hatchery trout. What we're going to try to teach you is to read the water. Now, what does reading the water mean? That means you're standing back on the bank beside my son, Jeff, who's going to be helping you on there. You're going to look out and you'll evaluate that pool. Where do you think that trout is going to be? Now, I'm not going to cheat. I'm not going to let you get him have a rising fish out there. Reading the water, where do you think that fish is going to be? Once you make that determination, then where do you need to drop your fly? So far, we're not there yet. Then finally, you've got to decide where to position yourself. Where's the trout? Where do I put my fly? Where do I put myself? The reason that third step is so important, you've got to be able to get a drag-free drift over that trout, whether you see him coming up or whether you just sort of assume that's where he is. Your fly has to drift naturally, just like the real fly, or he isn't going to take it. But that's what we're teaching in our schools. Sure, we're going to teach you how to cast. We're going to teach you how to do all the knots. We're going to teach you the hatches. We'll show you the assortments that match the hatches I was just talking about. We'll teach all of that. But the really bottom line gets down to, where's the trout? Where do I put my fly? Where do I put myself? Once you've got that, you can fish anywhere in the world. In the book that I wrote for the Shenandoah National Park, The Trout Fishing in the Shenandoah National Park, I wrote it that at their request. Actually, I didn't want to write it. A real good friend of mine kind of pressured me into it. I said, I don't want to give away all my secrets. He said, you just put them all in there and we'll let them decide. Well, that's what I've done. I've put all of our major streams in the park. Everything in the park now is done by milepost, starting at the northern end, going on down to Rockfish Gap. All the streams are in there in order that they fall going north to south. I do teach some of those here at the fly shop in Edinburgh, but that gives you the whole thing. Plus, in the book, I've got the hatch charts. Shows what's coming off, when it's coming off, and then the flies that you would use to match that. Reading the water is a very important part of that book. But all the streams are there. I counted just the other day. There are 21 streams that are accessible off of the Skyline Drive. Not all of the streams are accessible from down in civilization, so to speak. I'd say probably about half of them, but there are 21 of them that I went through the book and actually counted. There are 21 that you can get to off of Skyline Drive, and that's your land and my land, and that's open to the public. And just get up there, follow the trail, follow the directions I'm giving you in the book. There are three maps that cover the park, north, central, and southern, that are done by the Appalachian Trail Club. I've never found a mistake in those. The one edge that you'll gain from the book that you won't necessarily gain from the map is there are a whole lot of extra trails in the maps. friend of mine was overfishing one of them the other day, and he came back, and I said, Jack, how'd you do? He says, well, we zigged and zagged and got on the wrong trail. We walked for 3 hours and never found the stream. Well, the reason there's so many trails that are accessible off the Skyland Drive, because they're wonderful hiking trails. The Appalachian Trail, they take wonderful care of them, and you can just hike all over the place up there. But the book narrows it down. The book's going to tell you to walk so many yards one way, so many yards another way. When I wrote the book, I called a friend of mine who I knew had done a lot of research, actually employed by the park. And I said, George, I don't think it's really a mile and a half from where you're saying to start up there down to where that first branch is. He said, Harry, I walk them trails with those damn wheel things, and I know exactly that's a mile and a half. So if he walked it with that wheel thing, I'll take his word it's a mile and a half. And that's what I've given you in the book. I'm narrowed it down to exactly when to zig and when to zag. So if you have any questions on any of this, just give us a ring and we'll go over it with you. But we do the schools over there, we do the guide trips over there, and we'll be glad to help you. Just give us a ring at the fly shop in Edinburgh and let us know what you need.